The Mac version of ACDSee Photo Studio has always felt underpowered to me and lacking in features. So when I was asked if I wanted to review the new Photo Studio 9 for Mac, I was curious. Although I don't usually review software that I don't personally use, my curiosity got the better of me. After spending some time using the software, I realised that it's packed with features and I can't review them all. I'll therefore focus this review on the core features that make this a good or bad photo manager and editor. If you then want to know more about this software, check out the ACDSee website and download the trial version. I'll include the details in the YouTube video description. After launching the software, the first thing that struck me is how much this now feels like the Windows version. Whilst it still can't match Photo Studio Ultimate, it's a lot more capable than it was. If we look at the top right of the toolbar, you can see the different modules we have available. I'm currently in the Photo Manager, which is where we sort and organise images. Then, there's a viewer to examine individual images in detail without needing to first edit them. And finally, there's the Develop module, which is a RAW converter that you can also use for editing images. Over on the left of the interface, we see a list for exploring our image folders. There are several of these, but the two that I probably use most are Local, which you can use to look at the folders on your hard drive, and Removable to explore external disk drives. I've already configured this software to open my image library on startup. If I open the preferences, you can see there are lots of options to configure different aspects of the modules. When I select one of the folders in the list, I see the contents displayed in the main preview area. Unlike with Lightroom, you don't need to import your images for them to be visible. All files and folders in the selected folder are automatically displayed. I can then expand the list to select the folder that I want to view, or I can double-click it in the preview area. Now we can see the image thumbnails in the folder. The reason these are loaded so quickly is because there's a database holding the thumbnails. When you select a folder that's not in the database, the software scans it for images and saves a preview of these. Then when you select the folder in the future, it can load the thumbnails without needing to scan the files again. The database is also used for holding any information we assign to an image. The types of information that we might typically want to assign include ratings, color tags, and keywords. We can also organize our images into categories which we can add, edit, and delete. Let's look at an example of how you might want to use some of these features. I've already created and assigned a series of keywords to some of the images in this folder. Notice that it's possible to place the keywords into a hierarchy. If I right-click on a keyword in the list, I can then either add a new keyword to the list or add a sub-keyword to an existing keyword. It's also possible to click and drag keywords with your mouse to organise them into the hierarchy. It's then extremely easy to assign keywords to an image or images. Just select the images in the grid and then click the tick box to the left of the keyword. You then see a white tick on a blue background indicating the keyword's been assigned. Click it a second time and you remove the keyword from the image. One reason for organising keywords into a hierarchy is to make them easier to find in the list. But the list of keywords can still become very long, making it difficult to find the ones you want. To overcome this problem, you can create sets of keywords relating to a subject. If I click the list of sets, you can see a few that came as a default, but I've also created one called Blackpool. Let's edit the Blackpool set now to add a keyword, peer, and then save it. You can then see the new keyword in the set. Now when I'm editing my batch of Blackpool images, my main keywords are grouped together and they're easy to find. I can then click the keyword that I want to add to my image using the sets. And because this is the first time that I've used a new peer keyword, it's also added to the keyword list. Of course, keywords are only there to help you search for images, so let's find all the images with the Blackpool keyword. All I need to do is click the icon to the left of the keyword or keywords that I want to search for. I can then see all the thumbnails for images with those keywords assigned. But it isn't only my current folder that's being searched, it's any folder that's been scanned by the software and that's been added to its database. Now I have found one minor problem with this that is a little bit irritating. After searching for keywords, if I click the icon again to remove the filter, it leaves me without a folder selected. I would rather the software have left me in the folder of the image I had selected. In addition to keywords, there are other useful tools for organizing images. For example, I can add ratings to images as well as color labels. It's then possible to filter the thumbnail grid to show only images meeting my criteria. Now, back to the categories that I mentioned earlier. You can see that there are several categories already set up, and I've added a new one, which is Blackpool Finished. And like the keywords, you can organize these into hierarchies. Then, when I want to add an image to my category, I select the image or images in the grid and click the tick box to the left of the category. It's also possible to filter on the categories just like we did with the keywords, and you can use multiple filters. For example, let's look for all the images with the keyword Blackpool, which are in the finished category and which have a 3-star rating. Now let's come down to the bottom of the list, where you can see a section called Calendar. If we expand this, you can see that it organises all the discovered photos by their date, as well as giving the number of photos in that section. It's then possible to expand the date list and select all the photos shot on a given date. Let's use this to select all the photos that I've taken in 2020 and which are in the database. This is a handy feature if you don't already organise your images using a dated folder. Then I can refine those results to add the keyword Blackpool to the search. This means I'm finding all the images shot in 2022 with the keyword Blackpool. Now let's look at the special items list. You can see that this has several predefined searches which you might want to use when organising photography. For example, when I click Embedded Pending, you see all the images that I've already assigned something to, like a keyword or a tag. Another item is the images that aren't yet categorised, or those that don't have any keywords assigned. These are great for helping you to organise your photography. But there's another couple of items that I want to highlight, which are unnamed and auto-named faces. For anyone photographing people regularly, you'll probably find the face recognition feature valuable. As it discovers new images, the software scans them for faces, checking them against known people in its database. Let's look at the unnamed faces it's found in my photos. These images are recognised as having a face in them, but they aren't yet in the database. If I select one of the thumbnails, I can then switch to the View module. We can then use the Face tool there to select the face and assign a name to it. This is added to the database of names and will then be recognised by the software in future. Then if the software scans photos of this person in the future, it knows who they are. This allows us to also search for that person by name, and it will return all the images where this person appears. That's enough about organising images now, so let's go back to the View module. Now there are two things that I want you to notice. The first is that the PSB file doesn't show a thumbnail. That's because the software can't read the Photoshop large format file type. If it can't read an image type or doesn't have a thumbnail associated with a file, it shows the icon instead. The second point is what happens when I click a raw file thumbnail in the film strip. What you're now seeing is the image preview that's embedded in the raw file. You can see this indicator at the bottom of the screen, where you can also switch to viewing the decoded raw file instead. Then, over to the right of this, we have information about the image, and above this, a magnifier to inspect the image more closely. You also have the option to link the software to an external editor. When I click this icon, you'll see the option to configure an external editor if it doesn't already appear in the list. I've already set the software up to use Affinity Photo 2, so I'll select that. I then switch to the Affinity software, and the raw file that I was viewing is loaded for editing. After I've finished editing, I can export the image in one of the recognised file formats, or I can save it in the special Affinity Photo format. That file or files then appears back in ACDSee Photo Browser in case I want to access them again. Now let's switch to the Develop module and look at the raw editing tools. Over on the right of the interface, we have useful features like a history list and the ability to save and use snapshots. Then above this is a list of presets which you can apply to the image. The software comes with quite a few presets already defined, or you can create and save your own. Let's apply the Turing preset in the color category to this image. Now when you look at the controls on the left of the interface, you can see a blue dot next to any adjustments the preset made. In this example, you can see a colored LUT is being applied. When I expand that section, there's a list of LUTs that come with the software, as well as an option to import more. Also, when I click this arrow to the right, I can vary the strength of the LUT, as well as changing the blend mode. The blend mode for this LUT is currently set to soft light, but I could change it to, say, the color mode and increase the strength. Now, there are a lot of adjustment controls, and I'm not going to be able to run through all of them. Instead, I'll just use the fill light, highlight recovery, and contrast to correct this image. You then have the usual adjustments like tone curve and white balance, and there's an option to make local adjustments rather than global. Another interesting and useful control that you might not have seen before is the light EQ controls. This has three configurations from simple to advanced, and it's extremely effective. It allows me to target adjustments onto different tonal ranges in the image to make them lighter or darker. The different configurations just give me different levels of accuracy over the targeting. The color EQ control serves a similar purpose, but targeting color. There are also other controls here that you don't usually see in a raw converter, like the cross-processing effect and the soft focus effect. Then when I'm done adjusting the image, I can save it in one of a number of formats. Overall, this is a well thought out and capable RAW editor. But everything isn't perfect. Although I'm impressed, I've noticed a few areas that I think still need development. The first is that I haven't found any support for lens profiles. We do have tools to correct perspective, crop and level the image. But the lens corrections appear to be limited to basic barrel and pincushion correction. I would really like to see an option for applying lens profiles. That said, it could be that the software's already applying the lens correction that's embedded in a RAW file, but I'm just not aware of it. Next is that there isn't any support for soft proofing and printing as far as I can see. The software doesn't appear to be able to edit RAW files created using the high resolution mode on my Panasonic G9. Although it can present the embedded preview, if I switch to viewing the RAW file or try to edit the RAW file, this is what we see. This may be similar with other cameras, but I haven't been able to test that. And when it came to saving my images, I found the formats I could save in very limiting. Ideally, I would have liked to have seen the DNG format added to the list. Despite these minor problems, I would say that this is a good, solid photo manager and RAW converter. It probably makes a good pairing with the likes of Affinity Photo to manage your images. And for some people, the RAW development could even replace the develop persona in Affinity. If you would like to see how this version compares with ACDSee Ultimate on Windows, watch this video next. But before you go, don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you again in the future.